So hi, I'm Mark Bussey from Data Curation Experts. For those of you who don't know us, we're a small development and hosting shop that specializes in Samvera, Hyrax, Blacklight, Spotlight, and all the related open source projects and technologies. This is my friend River. And I know you came here to learn about a year of Hyrax in production. And I will talk about that. Bess and I were thinking about how to talk about this. And the best way is actually for me to talk to you about two very different visits I've had to see River in the last year. River's mom is Bess Sadler, who leads DevOps for DCE. So this is also a story about how having Hyrax in production impacts River's quality of life. Because when we started this out, the impacts weren't always all that positive. If you're here for a detailed list of the tools and the strategies and all the things and the technologies and scripts that we do, I will get to that at the end of the talk and have plenty of time for Q&A. But I'm going to talk more about sort of our shift in mindsets over the year as we've been doing this. The system that I'm going to talk about most specifically is an ETD repository that we're hosting for Emory University. In September of 2017, after about 6 months of development, we launched this application for them hosted on AWS cloud infrastructure. The goal was to replace the deposit and repository functionality of a legacy application they had that was pretty much falling over and unable to accept new student deposits. With the eventual goal of migrating all the content from that legacy system into the new system and shutting down the legacy system entirely. We are migrating the last 20 items from that legacy system this week, even as we speak. So we are just about at the end of that arc of getting all the content out of the old system and shutting it down. The first visit is the bad old days. So in April of this year, I had scheduled a visit to Carrboro, North Carolina, where River and her mom and dad, Bess and Tam, live. And the plan was for Bess and I to have 3 days of planning and strategizing, and then in the evenings have time to socialize with River and Tam. I landed, Bess picked me up at the airport. A few hours after my arrival, as we're sitting in her office, actually I think as we were having lunch, we had the first of a series of loud warning noises that Bess has configured on her phone and her computer and everywhere to let her know something is down. And it was telling us that the one of the components of the application had crashed for the Emory application. And so we sort of dropped everything and addressed the immediate problem, which was that Solar had crashed and we needed to restart it. And we tried to continue on. And then about 3 minutes later, the same thing happened. And we fixed it again. And then we thought we were okay because about 6 minutes elapsed. And we thought we were okay. And the same thing happened again. And we spent the afternoon largely sort of responding in that, trying to figure out what was going on and why this was happening. We ended up having a very rushed dinner. We made Tam stay downstairs with River, and we went back and holed up in the office. And we would keep restarting Solar every time it went down, and we finally realized that, well, if we're doing the exact same thing every time it goes down, maybe we could automate at least that part. We stayed up late, got that done. And the next day, we started the day by discovering that the problem had reoccurred overnight, but at least because there was an automatic restart, the downtime was now about 15 seconds instead of minutes or longer the first time we noticed it. What that did was at least give us some breathing room to think about the problem longer, but it turned out that throughout the next 2 days, those alarms kept going off at seemingly random intervals. We spent the next evening up in Bess's office, Tam and River down in the living room on toddler duty. I ended up feeling guilty because I'm disrupting home life. Bess felt guilty because we weren't getting to do the things that I had traveled to visit for. She felt guilty because Tam was stuck with toddler duty. And River was really unhappy because she didn't get to hang out in the office and figure out what Mark and Mom were doing. So all in all, it was not a very calm, soothing visit. Just last month, I made another visit to help lead a Samvera camp with Bess and with Carolyn. And I'm happy to compare that trip as being very different in its nature. The plan was to spend the week leading Samvera camp. We'd end up having breakfast with River before she went off to preschool. We'd come back after class, have a nice dinner, socialize, visit, play in the living room a little bit. But on the second day home from camp, Bess and I are driving home and we realize that, oh shoot, we had promised our friends at Emory that we would get a release out. And we had just completely lost track in planning for the camp and everything. And so we both momentarily panicked and we're like, oh my gosh, we're just gonna have to drop everything and go do that when we get home. And then we stopped and we realized that we had deployed this code to test environments and staging environments multiple times. We had created an automated post-deployment test suite that we could test what we deployed to make sure it was functioning the way we expected. And that we'd had it out on staging for almost a week, and everyone at the DCE and the Emory teams had looked at it and checked out both the content and the functionality. So we got home, and River and I ended up playing in the living room. Bess went upstairs to kick off a deployment, came back down and helped prepare dinner. She ran back upstairs really quick to just make sure the deployment had gone successfully. We had a really, really lovely, delicious dinner and visited and played some more. The next morning we got to class, we checked on Slack, we had a note from our friends at Emory that they were super excited with the new release. It felt really, really, really different than the visit in April. So what did we do? We did not actually hire River to be our lead for DevOps. What we had done in that time was committed to continually improving our processes and systems to minimize the amount of unplanned work that we had to react to. Because the problem with that first visit was that it was completely reactive. We were taken unawares. We didn't have tools to diagnose what was happening. And we realized that there were lots of holes in our system and our process. Much of what happened between those two visits happened in very small, very incremental, almost invisible steps. But I want to call out sort of three individual events that sort of highlight some of the things that we did to change through that time. So for the rest of the presentation, I am going to talk about and drop the names of the tools that DCE uses. In most cases, there's some other tool that will work equally well or possibly do some things better, and I'm not endorsing any of those specific tools. The thing that I think is important is to choose a good tool and get good at it. I just came across this presentation by Dan McKinley called Choose Boring Technology, and I want to quote from him because his ideas resonate really, really well with me. Think about what you're doing holistically and pick a few tools that cover your entire problem domain and solve all of your problems with them. The interesting thing here is that none of the tools that you pick may be the right tool for any given job, but can still be the right choice for the total set of jobs. It's important to master the tools that you do pick. And I think that's going to be a theme that that was true for us, at least. So during that August visit, or during that April visit, I'm sorry, the root cause ended up being a handful, actually just two PDFs that had a really weird structure. One of them had a huge amount of Korean language text in it. The other one had been rendered out of LaTeX for some mathematical notation. But the problem was that the system didn't actually crash when we tried to upload those documents. We use Honeybadger to report production exceptions so that when things happen, we have an easy way to get back to what and when. And it wasn't reporting anything when we'd upload those into test systems. When we looked at the timestamp of when solar was rolling over, using nagios to get those times back, we'd look at what was going on in the application and nothing unique was going on in the application. But still, the Klaxon alert that Bess had configured was going off again and again and again. So since our existing tools weren't working, we were trying to figure out what could the correlation be? And we'd been talking a long time about maybe looking at a log aggregation tool like Splunk or something like that. I had a little experience in the past with Splunk. We looked at gray log, gray something. We looked at a number of tools. We decided, hey, Mark has 8 hours more experience with Splunk than we have with anything else. Let's at least try that. What we were able to do with that is start tracing back, correlating all of our logs and tracing back and saying, okay, we know the failure happened here. What were some of the things that happened before that? And what we discovered was about 10 to 15 minutes before any the failure would occur, we would see these two processes go into our background job queue and side kick. It turned out that there was a full text extraction process going on that we never used, that was always failing because of the weird structure in these documents. And that what was happening was Solr was crashing not when it did the process, but when it later was trying to do garbage collection and get the memory back from these huge jobs. We would have never made that correlation without this tool that let us look at everything together. So we had already put in place the thing that let Solr restart, so we had some breathing room. But by now finding this correlation, what we realized is, hey, we don't actually need that job to ever run. Why don't we go turn that off, see if we can now deposit and if that solves our problem. We did that manually in a test environment, saw it worked. We then wrote that into our deployment script so that we could redeploy the entire, rebuild the entire server in one of our test environments. Saw it work there, reran the process. By the time we were pretty sure we had it nailed, we'd probably done the process 3 or 4 times. So we were pretty sure that we had done good testing, we had picked the right thing. So by the time that we were ready to roll those changes out to production, our risk to production was really low because we'd seen this happen successfully many times. And our confidence that it was the thing that fixed the problem was really high because we couldn't recreate the problem anymore in any of our test environments. So the key thing there was having the ability to scale up these test environments and doing this dress rehearsal, which has become a core part of our practice of let's do something many, many, many times before we try and do it in production. Let's have many, many different environments where we're running and not just our laptops. One of the pieces here is that it was impossible to replicate this problem in our local systems because it required the garbage dump behavior, which required us to have a fully loaded data set, and we didn't have the 5,000 items that we could easily get onto our laptops. So having a prod-like environment, having tools that let us clone that entire environment and just stand up a copy of it and work with our production data set turned out to be really powerful. So in general, that automatic retry feature of Sidekick is useful. It really helps when you have network outages or CPU or RAM utilization errors that cause transient problems. But like with that processing problem, there are times when a process fails, you can tell that it's never going to work again until you manually intervene. We learned this while we were working with a problem with browse everything and box uploading. Sometime after the PDF problem, we started experiencing user deposits where the user would deposit their ETD, everything would seem to go fine, they'd get all the correct confirmations back in the UI. And then when the administrator was notified that there was a thesis here ready to approve, there'd be no files attached. And again, no errors, no logging, anything that showed us anything unexpected. It turns out that there was an issue in Browse Everything that it looks for boxes status code return and assumes that that tells you whether the download was successful or not. What Browse Everything actually does is returns a 200 OK and an HTML message that says, we're sorry, your file wasn't attached. It's really nicely formatted and it's pretty, but it's not a PDF and it's not the file you wanted. But we were looking at status code 200 and the code thought, hey, this is OK. So the second piece was that because our system had been written to expect a PDF, it just detached the file because, hey, this isn't a PDF, this is HTML, I'm not going to attach it. We thought about a couple things to do, but ultimately what we decided is sit down as a whole team and think about this holistically. And what we ultimately decided was that there were actually two things that we needed to do. One was configuration and one was code. So one was, let's look at what we get back from Box and make sure that it's the thing that we expect and the kind of thing we expect, and throw an error if not, because it was just silently failing. Browse everything was silently failing on that. The second thing was that this was all happening because Box gives us a time-dependent access key. Once the user selects a file for download, that key is good for about 15 minutes. If we have lots else going on than the system in the queues and there's other jobs processing in the queue, our download job might not happen for 20 minutes. And lo and behold, that key has expired. So it took, again, multiple lenses from our team to figure out that was exactly what was going on. So the second piece was reconfiguring our systems so that we had a separate queue that let those time-dependent things happen in priority above everything else that was processing. Between those two things, that allowed us to one, ensure that it was unlikely to happen, and two, if it ever did happen again, we'd actually get an error and would know where to look. So again, the key thing there was really having everyone's from the team's eyes on the problem rather than just one or the other of us, because we had one solution that was fix the code, and that would have helped. And we had another solution that was fix the configuration, and that probably would have eliminated the problem for a long time, but still left the opportunity for it to happen. Between the two, we actually feel pretty robust in terms of what we've chosen to do. The last piece happened fairly recently. So it is the final migration of all of the legacy content. So for various reasons, it turned out that in addition to migrating all of the legacy ETDs, we also at the same time wanted to deploy an upgrade from Hyrax 1 to Hyrax 2, a sort of non-trivial thing. And we had some feature and functional upgrades to do at the same time. And we already had about, I think at that point, 200 new deposits from the new system in production already. So we had a new production data set that we had to merge with an old production data set and software upgrades to happen, and really complicated and a little scary. We talked about doing this in multiple phases, and the problem is really that our time and Emory's time was really constrained, and going through 4 or 5 cycles of QA and testing wouldn't meet the timelines that we needed to meet for both of us. So we said, okay, let's do it all together. But again, through virtualization and other tools, what we were able to do is clone our production environment, use reproducible Ansible scripting to create our new target environments, do trial migrations, and by the time we were done, I think we had probably done at least 5 full, all the content migrated migrations. Each time refining our playbook and our recipe for what we were going to do when we did it for real. And I don't know, probably literally in the counts of hundreds of partial migrations in that process. So again, we had a really high level of confidence in our process. The next thing that we were able to do is leverage the fact of virtualization, and a really clever idea that our friends at Penn State came up with of creating a read-only mode for the repository. We were able to place the existing new production system in read-only mode so that it would still respond to requests. You could do searches and discovery and download existing ETDs, but no one could deposit. So we chose a window when that was unlikely to happen. We put the system in read-only mode. We made a clone of it. We ran our full process in an offline version, meaning that it just wasn't public-facing. We had the full data set there. We did the software upgrade. We checked everything. We had a 2-page basically upgrade script of the manual things that we couldn't script. Did all those things, and then turned it over for about 3 days of rigorous tire kicking and testing by both our team and the Emory team. When all of that had happened and we've all felt good about it, rather unceremoniously, late one afternoon during working hours, we all gave the thumbs up, and we did a little tiny Amazon IP swap and put that new system into place that now had all of the legacy content merged with all of the new content and all of the new functionality. And did that with relatively little fanfare and not much notification to the user community. What that allow, and the final piece of that was that, and we kept the old system standing, so that if we found any problem with the new system, we could swap that back into place in, again, about 2 minutes. So all of these were really strategies about how do we move our work from reactive to something went wrong in a really critical environment to testing and practicing in a safe space where we could see the results and react thoughtfully, because back in that April cycle of the klaxon going off, I will admit that I think neither Bess or I were being at our most thoughtful. and we're fairly reactive. And shifting modes to those, how would we test? What kinds of risks do we have? Where do we create opportunities to ensure that we've checked all the edge cases? All of those were what got us from, I'm spending 3 days holed up in the office trying to get something to stop continually falling over, to, hey, I have a major deployment. Would you mind doing that while I make the salad? So those are the kinds of things that happened in the time frame. So it turns out that it's not just River who benefits from all of this, right? Bess is less stressed out. I'm less stressed out. All of our stakeholders are less stressed out. Processes that give us more breathing room and more resilient systems let all of us do more forward-looking, more thoughtful work. On the DCE team, which is a very small team, our scarcest resource is time. So we heavily leverage technology in all of that virtualization and other things. We heavily leverage our tools. But we're also trying to minimize our complexity and our cognitive overload in understanding all the parts that are going on. So part of this work was also taking out some things that we did realize we didn't need. So I talked about taking out the text extraction. We also consolidated some systems during this process. We did a number of things to make it easier to carry in our head everything that was going on. And the things that we couldn't carry in our head, we found tools that helped us explore and discover. The time that we have to learn new tools is limited, so we're trying to be very mindful about adding new tools to our suite. So when we had the solar service stopping, there's a couple tools that are very popular in the community that Bess had heard about that we thought about, hey, let's implement Datadog, let's implement something else. We realized that we had a big investment in Nagios already. Let's leverage that and increase our learning and our depth there. And the solution with Nagios, back to that, it may not have been the most elegant thing that could have ever been done, but incrementally on top of what we already had, it was probably the right choice for us. In contrast, that choice to implement Splunk as a new thing was we had no tool in our tool set that gave us the kind of visibility and inspectability that it gave us. So that was a new addition in our suite as we went through the year. So to summarize, it's really do all the stuff the textbooks tell you. So I have a reading list at the end, and all the things they say are right. The trick is you can't do it all at once. Minimize the complexity you have to deal with as much as you can. And I think most importantly that small changes add up. So all of the things that we did by themselves didn't seem too earth-shattering. But they led from a place where we were really being very reactive to a place where it feels much more planful and predictable. And we get to plan our lives much more than we did at the time. So this is basically the end of the sermon, of the talk. I've also included in the slide deck, which is available online, the tools and the processes and some of the memes that we use in our reading list. And so I'm happy to answer questions about those. So our tool set is largely AWS, GitHub, which anyone in the community is probably familiar with, Capistrano, Ansible. So hopefully none of these are too surprising or novel. It's not a huge tool set. Our brains aren't that big, so trying to keep that number of things that we have to learn down is one of the things that we discuss often. We do increase this over time. As I say, Splunk was a new addition within the last 6 months. We're right now looking at Catalan Studio, which is that tool that lets us script release tests. So we can look at a production system after it's been released and say, is this running as expected? Some of the practices to highlight out of what I said are test with real data, capture those edge cases when you find them, so those files, those sort of pathological PDF files, we have in a place where we can go test them again when we're running a new system. We actually have, from way back when, some JPEGs that had similar kinds of metadata issues embedded in them. So keep those around and know where to find them to run tests on new systems. Introduce change in small increments. Probably everyone in the room has maybe heard the terms continuous integration and continuous development deployment. We've made a change to sort of, and I've made a change from, you know, continuous integration meaning that I have Travis running, to meaning that we're trying to do our work in the smallest batches possible and get them all the way out through our deployment chain, and seeing them run in a production-like or a production environment and getting feedback on that, because it's way easier to fix and change and respond to them when it's small and recent than it is when it's the giant upgrade. We deploy early and deploy often, so any new project we start, we try and put production-like infrastructure up, usually within the first week of the project, and put Capistrano code on the Rails new application and start deploying right away so that we discover any problems with getting something out to a production environment early rather than late. Shortening our feedback loops are both part of this, but also just our conversations with clients and our conversations with one another. Trying to be ad hoc in real time over Slack or in person. We're all distributed, so it's often over Slack, but doing a quick Slack call is something that happens in our team a lot. Minimize the complexity of what we're doing. Trying to be really mindful about, is this complexity that we need to support the solution, or is this complexity that we're just letting drift in because technology? And swarming problems as a team. One of the things that we learned in the last 6 months is that our UI guy, some of you may know Jamie, is actually a really sharp systems guy and has some really useful input into some of the things that we're doing in building our Ansible scripts and setting up our servers. And if we hadn't talked as a team, if we had just left it to Bess and I, the DevOps people, we would have never discovered that or gotten those improvements. These are some of the buzzwords that come up in our conversation a lot. You can look for them in the back of the indexes of the books on the next slide, or Google them and get them to take you places. And these are some of probably the top books on our reading shelf around these sets of topics. So the Phoenix Project is a novel or an audiobook about the IT team in the midst of crisis and what they do to get themselves out of it. So it's actually informative of the story that I just told. The DevOps Handbook is sort of its companion piece of what the real recipes are for how to do this with your team. I just finished reading the Puppet State of DevOps report. That's always a great thing. This year's is really great in that it talks about five stages that they've discovered out of interviewing about 30,000 different IT professionals that they see organizations going through, and how to measure your organization and figure out the right next steps for you. And the Agile Samurai is an old book at this point, but says some very good things, and it's pretty technology agnostic. And we still refer back to it about how we talk about doing our practices. So that's the real reason that all of this is important. Right, it's to stop being reactive and have the time for the rest of our lives that we want to have. So we're happy to talk about the scripts and the tools and all the other technologies. You can reach me at Market Curation Experts, Bess at Bess at Curation Experts. River doesn't have email yet. I think the other thing is that, you know, all of us have various stages of this work to do, but the key is to do each time we can the things that we can to make our systems more robust, resilient, and reliable, and feed that back into the things that really matter. So I'm happy to go back to the tools, the techniques, the other things, answer any questions, or talk in any more detail about any of the particular scenarios, but I'm also probably at 1 minute out. You can ask and I can also repeat.
Okay. We use Ansible to deploy our Rails projects. I'm not a Rails developer. It's all fairly new to us. We were using Python and frameworks before. How can Capistrano and Ansible work together? Is that a thing?
So that's a thing for us. So the question is, how do Capistrano and Ansible work together, particularly in a Rails context? So when we say Ansible, we're often meaning configuration management and building the initial version of one of our servers or one of our boxes. So we use Ansible to make sure that if we're not actually, there are times when we just clone the thing, if we already have an instance of it. But otherwise, if we're building something new or trying to make changes, those are usually captured in an Ansible script that goes into GitHub somewhere. Once we have a system that we can SSH into, we're using Capistrano to take the code that's in our application repository in GitHub and do all of the many things that need to happen in a particular prescribed sequence to load that particular code onto a server, start all the services, stop all the services, update all the files that need to be coordinated, and do that in a way. So when we talk about deployment, we're often talking about using Capistrano, and when we're talking about configuration, we're often talking about Ansible. That's how they play in our world. So I think we're at the swap over break, but I'm around, and again, if you don't know me, many people know how to get a hold of my email. It's in the slide deck, and would be happy to continue the conversation if anyone wants to.